When in doubt, practice. When in doubt, practice. And we're always in doubt, are we not? Always in doubt here. We're always uncertain here. So what you do is you just start saying, okay, let's just see what arises. Let us put ourselves in the readiness for insight, flipping the script to arise. And let's see if the script can flip. I'm driving along the freeway today, and there's this tow truck and fire truck and policeman and everything, and a car had a minivan or something. It was not a minivan, it was an SUV sort of type, had rolled over, which is the worst thing ever. The whole top of it was crushed. A lot of symbology of rollovers recently, actually. So we need to, a lot of symbology of flipping. We need to flip the script. Wow. There's guys on a trampoline, these young boys who were jumping up and doing back flips and front flips right for me. I was right there and I was watching them. And said, hey, that's pretty good. Wow. They did many, many back flips and front flips and side flips and all sorts of stuff. So there's something about flipping coming along. Powerful, you know, constellation of this suddenly arose today. Okay. So you just look at that and say, okay, we're still fighting this not really knowing what's going to happen in the future. We're like spiritual orphans. We're all like orphans here because we don't really know what's going on. That's an orphan. An orphan doesn't know who his parents are. We don't really know our future. And we think our future is our parent. So I would say that we're all fighting the jitters right now. I certainly am. I'm trying to get reassurance, but it hasn't come yet today. So I'm trying to. It's a hot day today. It's like 90, at least 96 here. It's still very warm. Unexpected. They didn't say it was going to be that warm. So I didn't work out very much. I did my gas station workout, which is I get to a gas station and I find ways to do all sorts of workouts. I found a new one today. It was just great. So all day long, I'm finding ways to kind of work out as I take stops. Whatever I'm doing, I'll do a little, like a minute or two of working out. And I think this is how you have to do 24/7 on the spiritual workouts also, is just grab every little instant you can grab and just do a little mini workout, like a minute. Because the pressure on all of us right now makes it very difficult to have any sort of structured kind of workout. Certainly here we in the United States and probably a lot of places, you feel like a cultural orphan right now, kind of. Because our culture is not really presenting the future to us in terms of how are we supposed to be in the culture. It's not really presenting it. I don't feel that it is. It's almost like it's like a void, the way I see it. Waiting for this cool breeze to help us out here. Quite warm. Had to rest for a couple hours, just feeling so tired from all the stress and the workouts, but stress and push, and we're like 11 days away, almost virtually 10 days away now, I think, from D-Day. And we still have not got... We're closing in on it, so we're not giving up. And usually I manage to succeed right at the right time. This has been my story, so I don't panic when a deadline is coming. I have confidence. Okay, great. We talk about superhypnosis. Okay, so we're looking for superhypnosis. Superhypnosis, part of it is practicing on the fly, continuously, whenever the, you know, whenever the a little opportunity, you make a little opportunity, a little minute here, a little minute there. I do a little minute workout. I did before this video. It's just stuff that like takes you maybe just a minute, actually. There's so much stuff you can do in 1 minute. I can do 100 jump ropes in a minute. You can do squats, a squat workout in a minute that really hits your legs hard. Just 1 minute. You could do affirmations, spiritual affirmations in 1 minute. There's never been anyone who's not enlightened. There's never been anyone who's not enlightened. There's never been anyone who is, there's never been anyone not enlightened. Never been anyone not enlightened. Never been anyone not enlightened. There's never been anyone not enlightened. There's never been anyone not enlightened. This is a fact. There's never been anyone not enlightened. Keep in mind, Longchenpa kept away from the gradualist approaches. He said, nah. And we are too. Now, I suggest when you realize that there's never been anyone not enlightened, that you don't try to define it. Define your experiencing. Don't try to define your experiencing, because our experiencing really is freedom. As soon as we try to define it, we lose sight of it. So we shouldn't try to stuff it into any tradition, which are full of definitions and conventions. Those are practice conventions, which are fine. But ultimately, there isn't any, reality doesn't have any convention to it. So people, what's the number one convention in this world? Failure. Failure to realize that there's never been anyone not enlightened. There's never been anyone not enlightened. There's never been anyone not enlightened. This is a fact. And the number one convention here is failure to realize that. It's an overwhelming convention. And so the questions that people ask are really just saying, well, you have to put it into this convention of failure. So your success has to be a failure. And I recognize that today. Asking questions is just a convention. Who needs to ask questions? There's never been anyone not enlightened. So if someone asks questions, it's ridiculous. Questioning is a convention designed to distract us from that which is. As it isness. Designed to distract us. So everything we do in this world, it's our conventions to distract us from as it isness. Conventions of distraction. So asking questions, asking for explanations, those too are conventions of distraction. And we need to realize this. It's all a distraction. How can we entertain the notion of separation except to distract ourselves from as it isness? So everything we've been doing is simply a convention of distraction. Even the spiritual path is a convention of distraction. But the spiritual path is really just our efforts to recognize that everything we've been doing is a convention of distraction. Ultimately, including focusing on convention of distraction also. But it's kind of like you gradually make, you know, less and less distraction, less and less and less and less and less. And then you ultimately realize that everything I've been doing is just a convention of distraction. So it finally evaporates all continuity fear. At that point, you just experience as it isness. So really the path is a path of repentance. Spiritual path. It's not a path of adding something on, attainment, getting empowerments and attainments and all. It's not a path like that. It's a path of repentance, of acknowledging that this too is arrogance. This too is arrogance. This too is a convention of distraction, and not this, not this, not this. You see, you progress. You see more and more and more All of this is just conventions of distraction. It's like that airplane flying over. Convention of distraction. Right? It distracts us. Right? So we have all these airplanes flying in our thinking, in our conceptualizing, in our habits. Our habits are like huge airplanes flying over lower overhead. And just like, oh, there goes another one. Oh, there goes another one. And we've got all our attention on the airplanes. Those are just conventions of distraction. So all we've ever done with existence is just a convention of distracting it from as it isness. Nothing more, a collection of habits. Conventions, meaning we collectively agree, like, well, yeah, let's try this. And we keep collectively agreeing on all these different conventions in the world. That's all the world does. It just seems to be a collection of getting together, and we agree on this convention and then another. So you get all these different conventions in the world. That's all it is. And then we categorize them and group them into various cultures and traditions, etc. But they're just agreed upon stuff that we agree, like, yeah, this would be helpful to distract us from as it isness. Let's try this. Let's agree that we're going to try this. Let's agree that this is going to lead us to greater happiness than reality has for us, something greater than perfection. And so we've been working at this for so long, collectively, as Jesus tells us, he says, all of existence is a collective endeavor among many of the sons of God, many aspects of spirit. And we've been working at it for just unbelievably, you know, number of moments. To an extreme extent, he says, to try and produce, you know, just the perfect distractions. And so this, the body, the world, all these are conventions of distraction that we've collectively worked on. That's all they are. And what is distraction from as it isness? What's the benefit? There's no benefit at all. It's as if we were trying to find out how minimalist can we make our creativity? Can we make our creativity disappear? And so people say, well, we can't quite yet make it disappear, but we've got it really minimalist. We're minimalizing it, and we're intrigued by this minimalism of our creativity. Jesus says that the light we've imagined is frozen. It appears to us to be frozen to the most unbelievable extent. But it's still the same living light. Yet we're trying to experience this minimalness of living light, of creativity. And so everything here is very fragile and very quaint and very minimal in this creativity. And we're enthralled by this, actually. We think, oh, this is really special. So we always keep thinking we have to continue to exist through convention, through agreed upon conventions, that without that somehow that our creativity isn't functioning well. But we're really trying to minimalize our creativity and try to get rid of it, actually, as if getting rid of it would prove that we're greater than God, because God created us as this creativity. And if we get rid of it, that means we that God isn't God, essentially. That's the only way that we can really pretend that we're God, is to try and prove to ourselves that God isn't God. You see, we can't do it in a positive way, actually, say that we are God. But all we can do is try to disestablish God as God. And so we have these conventions of seemingly disestablishing that God is God. So what we say here is that nothing's ever happened at all as far as disestablishment. Each generation comes in, they say, hey, your conventions, you know, they're a little flimsy. We think we can make better conventions of distraction. That's all that happens here. And indeed, you know, maybe they have made better conventions of distraction. The smartphone is, you know, it's extremely distracting, right? And so we're patient here. We're just looking at everything here, and we know how it works. We prepare, and then the breakthroughs come when we're prepared for it. No one has, there's never been anyone who's not enlightened. There's never been anyone who is not enlightened. So what are we doing? You see, this is what the question. Wait a minute. You look at it that way. Start looking at it that way. There's never been anyone who's not enlightened. Never. So what is this search for enlightenment? That's a convention that helps us fail. The gurus are the ones that kind of bust us up about the search for enlightenment. Say, give up the search. What are you doing? That's just another convention. But we're the ones that say, oh no, I'm really searching for enlightenment. I really want to find this. There's no finder of enlightenment. Everyone's already enlightened. There's never been anyone who's not enlightened. So we're working on flipping the script here. When you feel a little bit down, you have to start working on flipping the script. And that leads to affirmations, and that leads to wow, and it leads to breakthroughs. So you can always practice in some way. It's very warm indeed here. This heat snuck up on us. I was supposed to cool down here and be in like the low 80s for like the next 10 days or something like that, after tomorrow. You know, in other words, delightful, incredibly delightful weather. But this is really very warm. They say around the globe is record-setting heat so far this summer. Record-setting heat, yeah. There's never been anyone who's not enlightened. So what are we doing? So this may help us to say this. There's never been anyone who's not enlightened. There's never been anyone who's not enlightened. There's never been anyone who's not enlightened. So what are we doing? We're trying to distract ourselves from this fact. So our aim is to get free of the distraction. And what is it that holds us to the distraction? Continuity fear. I guarantee everyone that if we didn't have any continuity fear, we would drop all distraction instantly. Automatically, instantly, we would just all drop it all if it weren't for continuity fear. So that's why I say continuity fear is the only problem there is. Without continuity fear, again, we'd all be, all distraction would instantly be dropped. And we'd all realize that there's never been anyone who's not enlightened. We're all Dharma kings from the beginning, without having to do anything to establish it at all. What we are has no need to be established. We are reality itself, which is all there is. So what need does it have to establish itself? There's nothing outside of it or anything other than it. There's never anything other than as it isness. There's never been anything other than as it isness. So as we say these affirmations, all we're doing is evaporating our continuity fear, okay? And that's all we need to do, because that's the only problem there is. Once we evaporate enough of our continuity fear, then automatically we'll drop the distractions and we'll see, we'll experience as it isness. We realize we are as it isness. Everything is as it isness. There's nothing other than as it isness. There's nothing other than as it isness. But we're saying these as affirmations, not analytical explanations, actually. We now, err on the side of caution, I say. At this point. So in other words, be conservative, meaning cautious, err on the side of caution, and err on the side of caution at this time in the world. Now, what we need to do is to maintain the mental austerity. It's all important. In other words, stay away from the distractions. And we need to do this by erring on the side of caution. So we need some severity, and we have to accept the severity as a precautionary measure. Err on the side of caution. We might have to have, be pretty strict with ourselves at this point in history. This is my recommendation. So we're getting help from those who are experts in austerity, which you might say are the Tibetan Buddhists. They're certainly helping out Westerners, helping out everybody out who asks for help. And what they bring is this tradition of austerity of mind. They've lived very austere lives. They may be going Western and less austere now, and that they may be getting pulled into less austerity. In fact, they probably are compared to how they used to be. But comparatively, they're quite austere. A great master such as Jamyang Kyentse Choki Lodro was very austere. Lived the life of complete, from birth to death as a monk, austere monk, and was very strict. It was the Kathdok monastery we reestablished. He's known for being extremely strict as far as austere discipline and austerity, and don't break the rules. You got to stick to it. So we might be shaking in our boots, and everybody did shake in their boots, apparently, because he was known to just be this, crack the whip sort of type. And like we're saying, we're Westerners, we can't handle that. That's terrible. But I would say, it's fine. Err on the side of caution. Sure. We're a different culture, different background, all this stuff. But mental austerity is mental austerity. And it would be better at this point to err on the side of caution. So this is how I look at it. Try to just keep, okay. I'm not that enthused by being orphaned in some tradition that wasn't brought up in, And maybe that's not what's going to happen either. I don't know. But the principle, I would say, is mental austerity, which I have certainly lived. And gotten better and better at it, and realizing how important it is. You can't fool around, because distractions will grab you. Distractions from as it isness are this whole world is a distraction from as it isness. Everything is that we are experiencing, we seem to be experiencing, is a distraction from as it isness. Only as it isness is not a distraction from as it isness. Okay? Anything else is a distraction from it. That's all that it is. So we've certainly come up with a massive, massive armada of distractions through our own efforts, just to see how distracted we can make ourselves. Well, we've made ourselves very distracted. And the world is hurtling towards extreme distraction. So, theoretically, we don't have to be, we might say, well, we don't really have to be too austere, and we don't have to really do this, and we can kind of, you know, playing it cool. But that's just theoretically. Practically, it's really very important to be in some situation that is austere and not, well, here's an example. All the new cars that are coming out and the materialism, there's always something. And we're always a little bit intrigued about the future, about, yeah, you know, I want to be austere, but there's just one car I'm kind of interested in. And there's so much coming out right now. I've been talking about cars with people. There's something about that is we say, yeah, I want to be austere, but not quite yet. And I would submit to everyone that this attitude, if you ask, what has caused me to be reborn here in this world, to be in this ocean of hideous pus, it's the terrible, ferocious poisons of distraction. It's such a miserable place. We don't want to think about it because we seem to be here. We try to make the best of it. But what is it that keeps us, you know, why are we here? Because we had this attitude of, yeah, I really want to be austere and all this, but there's just not quite yet. Not quite yet. I'm going to. But, you know, there's just the electric cars that are coming out. There's like some really interesting electric cars coming out, and I kind of feel like I kind of want to just see what that's about, you know. And there's, you know, new this stuff, inventions and things. In other words, all the stuff of materialism, it intrigues us just enough, so we say, yeah, I'm going to be austere for sure. I'm there. I agree with you. Yeah, I agree with everything you're saying. This is typical. You know, people. Our mindset will listen to spiritual teaching and say, yeah, I agree with everything. Absolutely, I do. It's the right way. And I'm there. I'm just about there. But I'm just, you know, almost. And that's exactly the attitude that brings us into rebirth. Because keep in mind that these bodies and these worlds and distractions are nothing but a mental excuse that we're using. The mind is blaming some dynamic other than its own desire for its suffering and problems. As long as the mind refuses to take responsibility for everything, all of this distraction, it's 100% our own arrogance, which the idea of wanting to separate from God and be greater than God, that prove that God isn't God, it's 100% that. As long as the mind refuses to accept that it's 100% that, the mind will have to have an excuse to blame for the 1% that it claims isn't coming from mind. So where is that coming from? The mind has to project some excuse, and that excuse has to be what we call time, space, process, and form, body, something to blame. Something to blame. So these bodies are nothing but something from the mind to blame. That's all they are. They have nothing to do with what we are. They're just the whipping boys. That's it. This world, all this is just so we can have, the mind can have something to blame and refuse to take responsibility. That's all the mind does. This is all this is, refusing to take, mind refusing. So if the mind doesn't take responsibility, it has no other choice but to blame something. And there's nothing to blame in reality at all. So it has to project a dream that it claims is causing the mind to act the way the mind is acting. The mind says, no, I'm not causing this, something else is. Well, then it has to believe there's something other than the mind. So it has to create something that seems to be like a robot that is functioning automatically and stuff. And it says, nature is causing the mind to be the way it is. It's all an excuse. Nature is an excuse. All this nature you see, the world, bodies, is nothing but an excuse the mind has conjured up to blame. No, God, I'm not responsible for all my arrogance. No, it's nature that's causing the you know, the rest of it. I might be a little bit, you know, responsible, but not that responsible, not completely. And so again, why we find ourselves here is because we were not willing to take 100% responsibility. Maybe we took 99%. Well, guess what? 99% gets us a return ticket here. And in fact, most of us are here except because we took 99% ownership of our problems, but not the last 1%. And that's exactly what tricks us into returning here. And we think, God, I did such a great job. I accepted 99% of it. It's like saying, God, I accepted 99% of responsibility for trying to undermine you and so that you're not God. But that other 1%, that's not coming from me. That's coming from somewhere else. It's coming from this nature and bodies and stuff. Which means that it's just trying to trick God, saying that actually, God, you can be undermined, and you are being undermined, and I believe you are, because I believe that there's some power other than you, you see? And God would say, well, who made that? Who made the nature? I said, I don't know. I thought you did, right? God says, no, I did not. He says, well, it just arose somehow. It was spontaneously, miraculously, I don't know, it just arose, and you know, and it's affecting me. It's causing my arrogance, God. Nothing could be further from the truth. So most of us feel that we've done a really good job spiritually, and we've accepted most responsibility, and we said, well, that's enough. We've accepted enough responsibility. There's got to be, we've got to give some responsibility to nature, to bodies here. They have something to do with this. And the truth is, they have nothing to do with it. Nothing to do with it. Nothing to do with it. So this is what we have to emphasize. It doesn't do any good to go over 99%, be a 99%er, because that's what we all have already been. We've already been 99%ers, and here we are again. That's precisely the game we've been playing, is to be 99%ers. And so we're just notice that, say, ah, great to notice that, wonderful. Someone told me that eggs and avocado are great. It didn't taste that good, but it's probably pretty good for you. A whole avocado and a couple of eggs. I just felt like I needed, I've been working out so much, I needed to. Yeah, I've got to keep eating. I'm gaining a lot of weight. I've gained like four pounds at least. But that's okay. And so we're just looking at this together, we're just noticing this, not freaking out about anything at all. You say, oh, interesting, right? Yeah. And so we repeat the exact same mistake over and over and over again. The exact same mistake is, I'm trying, God, I'm trying, I did a great job, God, to the end of our lives, I did a really good job. What do we do? Well, I really whittle it down, and I accept the 99% responsibility. It's like unbelievably great, great, you know, what a life. But isn't that leaving that 1% like that, isn't that our attempt to trick God and say, God, you know, there has to, I mean, aren't you going to accept 99%? Accept, don't, you know, like that. So you got to accept me, God, the way I am. I'm 99% not arrogant. Okay? But 1%, that's not important. But that's the desire to be arrogant. It's still there. We're not something that we can divide ourselves into percentages. We're 100% always. We're 100% always. So the idea of saying, well, I'm 99% is ridiculous. That means that's an arrogant statement. Completely arrogant statement to make. But we keep playing this game thinking that, yeah, we're gonna finally, God's gonna finally say, oh, okay, 99%, that's really great job. Whereas the whole purpose of it is to trick God, to deceive God, so that we can say, you see, we got you, God, we tricked you, you're not really God, you see that? You fell for the 99% trick that we've been trying out, playing on you. So we just keep trying to do that. Doesn't work at all, does it? Find ourselves back in this world, which is just an excuse. We find ourselves identifying with an excuse. The mind has to. Well, what else can it do? If it's claiming that it's not responsible, but where's the evidence for something that is responsible? It has to have some evidence to point to. It's called blame. You can't just blame nothing. I mean, it blames. Yeah. In the afterlife, the mind also blames the afterlife for that. Even the afterlife's all just a convention. But it's a flimsier blame. The blame is flimsier. It's kind of like not as strong. So the mind feels much more, ultimately kind of says, I feel jittery. I feel like God's going to see through this. So it then goes back to identifying with something that's really, really solid, you know, seems to be a real solid excuse, which are bodies in this world, nature and stuff, the way that we're experiencing it now. It seems to be a really heavy, solid excuse, like, yeah, it's a really good one. And the afterlife excuses are not quite, you know, not quite as strong. They start getting more and more flimsy. And so the mind that is insistent on making an excuse cannot see as it isness, cannot experience as it isness, cannot be as it isness, cannot accept it. So it has to search for excuses. But it's only projecting its own excuses. This is all a mental projection. We're only seeing mental projections when we're seeing excuses. So it will continue to mentally project in as an excuse. That's it. There's nothing else it can do. Nothing else it can do. And I saw this today. I said, oh, wow. Yeah. I mean, either it makes an excuse or it doesn't. It just says, well, I'm making a real good excuse. Well, that just means I'm strengthening my delusion. So mental austerity. Err on the side of caution. You don't have to be all whoopee about it, you know, the future. Okay, but it's just there are times when it's super important to err on the side of caution. Be very conservative in that regard. As far as let's play it cautious here now. And the world is playing it very overconfidently right now. Extremely overconfident. You've got a lot of people in a lot of positions that historically they have no experience in whatsoever. And we're all supposed to go along with them and tell them, oh, you're doing a great job, doing a great job. And yet they're just making it up as they go along. They're just winking it in terms of the positions of power that they have seized, and that we're supposed to just go along and pretend that they know what they're talking about. In fact, they don't know what they're talking about. They're way overconfident. They don't know austerity. They don't know how to lead and guide, etc., very well at all. And so we would be well suited to have help from those who do know what they're talking about, who have a long tradition of know-how, and who really know how to play on the safe side, the cautious side. That would be super helpful for us, actually. And I ran into a situation today. I don't identify what was happening, but it was, we call it the quote-unquote yoga girl thing. It was very prevalent what happened, and the yoga girl is, you know, large and in charge, as if she knows exactly what's going on. She knows the lingo, she knows this, but you could tell she doesn't really know what's going on. But you don't dare say that. There's a convention that's been built up here. You never criticize women because you never want to suggest they need to take responsibility. The whole thing about feminism is that women not taking responsibility for the mental mistakes that they're making. They said that's men's fault. It's just so they projected upon men their own inner arrogance, their own arrogance, and said, no, men are arrogant. We're not arrogant at all. Men are the problem. We don't have any arrogance. This is the yoga girl thing, which is the disaster in the world. And so they said, no, what the problem is that we have all these arrogant men in charge of the world. If we're in charge, we can have peace on earth. You know? Again, anyone that believes they're in a world, that believes in nature and bodies, is a maniac, total maniac. So what they're saying is, no, we're not maniacs at all. We're perfect. And everywhere, but the men, they're the maniacs. So you couldn't have a more ill-suited kind of ideology than that. Now, men have generally basically said, yeah, we're maniacs, but you are too. Women, you are too. You're also maniacs. That's Christianity. We're all sinners. You don't make a distinction between men and women in Christianity as far as sinners. No such distinction exists. But culturally now, that feminism basically has destroyed that. It's the worst ideology ever, actually. And so now we have a situation where half the world feels they're perfect and not arrogant and believes all problems then come from the other half, men who are terrible, maniacs, arrogant, and should never ever have any influence again. Their only purpose is to brown nose the women. And yes, ma'am. And you get this ideology that says the only purpose of men is to worship women. I mean worship their wisdom, inherent wisdom, which is supposedly free of arrogance. Again, any belief in nature at all is total arrogance. All arrogance is total arrogance. Any belief in a universe is total arrogance. Any belief in beings, so to speak, is total arrogance. Any belief in bodies is total arrogance. Any belief that anyone's ever been born is total arrogance. So the entire scope of every feminist belief is nothing but total arrogance. And all arrogance is total arrogance. There's no such thing as, well, I'm 99% not arrogant. It's all total arrogance. This is what the path is all about, recognizing. There's no such thing as 1% arrogant. That's why they say enlightenment's sudden, meaning it comes about when we recognize and accept this fact that you can't be a little bit arrogant. It's impossible. Because a little bit of arrogance is the overlooking. It has to be what? The overlooking of reality. And that has to be total. The reality is not in bits and pieces. So I said, well, I'm seeing some of it, but I'm overlooking some of it. That's complete delusion. That's not reality at all. So, it's like everyone's ignoring the elephant in the room. It's just amazing. It's pathetic. No one has the guts to speak up and say what's going on. Except here, it seems like. They're too busy trying to collect funds. I got to tell you the truth. Most funding comes through women now at this time. Even if, you know, this foundation, you know, the Mr. and Mrs. Foundation. But it's the women that decides, okay, I want to put some of our money into this. I want to donate this. Generally speaking, that's how it goes. So all these religious institutions that are trying to spread themselves throughout the world and strengthen themselves and such, they rely on the generosity of women. So they cannot say what I'm saying here. They would withdraw their foundational grants, for sure. They'd cut it off. So the women are very careful to only support those who allow the women's prerogative, which is to claim that they're not as arrogant as men. But that's then to claim that there's degrees of arrogance, which is total delusion. So it strengthens delusion. To say that there's degrees of arrogance is absolutely the Antichrist position. So for me, I don't have any money at all. I'm not getting any funds from anybody. I work for my own, you know, funding, which is virtually nothing. But I just have, you know, I just tape. I don't have any overhead in terms of producing books or doing anything. Traveling, I don't do any traveling. So I don't have any funding. So I'm not beholden to women for you know, my funding, so I can tell the truth about the situation. Where you're not getting the truth from other situations, they're very circumspect about it, which is what I've seen. It's way too circumspect. You can see that the priests, how they tiptoe around it. You know, they'll do a little jab just to say, yeah, you know, you might be a little bit arrogant, you know, still. But the men, oh yeah, they're just like 100% arrogant. You know. And women go, great, here, let's write a big check. You know, it's really blackmail that's going place. The woman says, look, you kowtowed and catered to me, to my vanity. Great, let me write you a big check. Oh, you didn't? I'm going to boycott you and talk to all the women. We're going to cut off all your funding. It's blackmail, plain and simple. I don't know many men that can write a check over the wife's objections. There might still be a little bit of that left, but probably it's virtually gone right now. Because they get hell for it, and to be nagged to death. Nagging is abuse, actually, severe abuse, because it wears you down bit by bit, cut by cut, little cuts, until your whole body is just a mass of painful sores and infections. And they claim, oh, no, I just made a little cut, you know, like that, just a little cut. This is the way. So we've agreed upon these conventions that distract us from as it isness. And so the male-female things, these are just conventions we've agreed upon, very successfully distract us. They're just conventions of distraction. That's all they are. We have nothing to do with male or female in the spirit. It's 100% convention. But we need to look at these conventions and say, wow, this is how we're, you know, deluding ourselves, distracting ourselves. And, you know, I always say I'm an orphan because there's nobody who's willing to say they're my friend because they're afraid their funds are going to get cut off. That is correct. That is correct. So it's blackmail. In other words, you're saying I'm afraid of blackmail. Because the truth is, all arrogance is 100% arrogance. And if you're not arrogant, you are absolutely realizing you are as it isness. Right here, right now, and that's all there is. And you'd have the radiant presence like Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. I don't know too many women have the radiant presence of Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, if any. Okay, so they're still arrogant, and all arrogance is 100% arrogance. So there isn't any saying, well, you men are more arrogant. That's nothing but a clever distraction, that egoic distraction that spirit's using. It's not women that are using it, it's spirit. Women, bodies are just neutral. They don't do anything. They're just puppets. This is all mental projection. So it's spirit that's doing this. It's not the men. It's not the women at all. It's spirit. The bodies are innocent. Bodies are not causing anything. Keep in mind, right? It's spirit is saying, no, that I might be 99% arrogant God, but there's something else causing the other 1%. This is not true at all. Totally false. That is the lie. That's the egoic lie right there. So I keep working out, and I'm exhausted. I feel just like, wow, just hammered. But what else is there to do? You know, spiritually work out, physically work out, body, mind, and speech work out, body, mind, spirit. Just keep working out. The whole world's under this blackmail right now. And as I think no one's willing to be associated with me. And I know exactly why. Everyone that has, I say, I guarantee you that there's a woman who's threatening to cut you off if you don't play this little game of that you're more arrogant than she is. Which is simply not true at all. All arrogance is 100% arrogance. But we play this game of shuffling it around. Now, it used to be that we played the game in the other way a little bit. Is it that the women were more arrogant than the men. But this was sort of a counterbalancing thing of the previous thing. So it keeps going back and forth to try, whoa, we're out of balance. Let's go back and, you know, at some point, well, people say, well, it's the women that are more arrogant than the men. No, the arrogance isn't coming from men or women. It's coming from spirit. It's always spirit that's arrogant. It's never anything other than spirit. And all arrogance is 100% arrogance. No such thing as 99% arrogant. Or no such thing as 1% arrogant. No such thing as 99% not arrogant and 1% arrogant. No such thing. It doesn't exist. That itself is a totally arrogant denial of reality. There's no exceptions to reality. There's no exceptions to truth. The truth is not 99% true. And reality is not 99% everywhere. Everywhere is not 99%. And then there's 1% that's not everywhere. So we really haven't gotten anywhere in the world. In fact, we're worse off than ever. Because of this, the spirit decided the old trick of feminism. That's a trick that's been used many times. When we're really starting to get it and awaken, spirit uses this trick. It's used this trick many times. And now it's, you know, oh. And so the whole culture, conventions now, we've completely changed our conventions, shuffled the deck. It's the same deck, it's just we're just shuffling it. We deal different hands at different times to distract ourselves. But so we now have this different hand being played. And conventions. And the entire culture is just, you know, has shifted into this. It's just astonishing looking at it. I said, what? See, Christianity was never that way. It's everyone is a sinner here. We're all equal sinners. This is the root of Christianity, and this is the root of truth. Okay. People, you know, sell Christianity short, because the ego does, of course, because it's very threatened by Christianity, actually. Very, very threatened. And that is simply to say, you know, we're all equal sinners here. There's no greater or lesser sinner in the world. This is the root of Christianity. This is the root of wisdom, actually. So Christianity is very simple, which is wonderful, which is why it's very threatening to the ego. Ego likes a lot of complexity. Christianity is very simple. We're all equal sinners. And this then is a way of saying all arrogance is 100% arrogance. So there's no such thing as saying I have a little bit of arrogance. And since we're here in this world, this is the absolute evidence, 100% conclusive evidence that we're arrogant. And of course, the avatars, the gurus, the saviors, because we believe that we are here, they have an appearance here. But the body is neutral. So the fact that a body appears, it is possible for a body to appear here, but not be the cause, not be arrogance. It is possible. But you would know that. You would. It's like Jesus. You could tell that his body appearance was not due to arrogance, but all the rest of us, it is, including myself. Including you, including everybody listening, including virtually everyone on the face of the earth at this point, all contemporaries. We're here because of arrogance, no other reason. There's no other reason whatsoever. We talk about karma, that's just arrogance. That's a distraction. All karma is just another convention. Karma is just another convention. And now Christianity points this out, is all this stuff, it's just sin. It's just arrogance. What's sin? It's arrogance. And it's these imaginary regrets, you know, that, oh, I was too arrogant here, and I could have been less arrogant here, and all this stuff. No, it's all 100% arrogance. These are just conventions. Everything here is a convention. So if you take a convention to be true, that's also arrogance. That's the vision of arrogance, you might say. So the vision of arrogance is blinding us to the vision of as it isness. And yet the vision of arrogance is nothing but these conventions we've agreed upon. There's nothing generating it. It's just other than our mind. There's no other source of generating all of these conventions except our own mind. And we've been very tricky about it, trying to disguise this. And yet, disguise is only disguise, right? It doesn't change what's under the disguise at all. Camouflage doesn't change what's under the camouflage at all. So I prefer this teaching. This is why I do it. I feel comfortable doing this teaching. It's just relief to me because I want to hear the truth. I can't get the truth from the world. Nobody's willing to say it. They can put it into, you know, it's there, but you can tell and say, look, we don't want to push this too much. This is the Samaya thing also, is they don't want to get their benefactors too upset about, and so they keep the teaching secret. But this is what they're really teaching, but they don't want the benefactors, which basically are women. I mean, the princesses, aristocratic women, the women with money. They're the ones that say, this is really important to me. I want the king, I want you to, donate this amount of money. And the king has got to say yes. Doesn't want to be have a campaign to destroy his nerves come about. So they agree. So these teachings are kind of secret because you don't want the money people to find out what is it you're teaching. You want to flatter their egoic vanity and say that, oh, you're wonderful, and give these blessings and blessings this and oh, okay. But that's I just don't go for that really. I feel I've had to live that way my whole life. It's a double life. I don't like it. It's really a double life. It's terrible. Because the continuity fear of spirit, if you don't dance to its defenses, it becomes ferocious. It becomes very ferocious. So the Buddhas, like Buddhists, are very circumspect. I mean, they're like masters of marketing, so circumspect about it. And say, yes, all this is wonderful. Yes, this is great. Everything you're doing to help the world, that's wonderful. That's really great. We're not against that. In fact, we support it. It's wonderful, wonderful. But really, ultimately, Buddhism is about, realizing Buddha mind, and then they let it go at that. And then the donors say, oh, okay, so we can keep on living the life we've lived, and that's okay with Buddhism. Oh, yeah, sure. Okay, let me write you a check. Because let's face it, all this stuff costs money, 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 money. There's so much money flowing into these religions, into everything, except me. There's no money flowing in here at all. Not even a penny is flowing in. And people might say, well, yeah, well, if you just kind of, play it both ways, then maybe you'll get some funding and stuff. Yeah, but that's just doing what everyone has always done here. And what kind of success have we had here in the world? Very little. And what such kind of situation we're in right now? We're in the worst situation the world's ever been in right now. So Christianity confronted that head on and said, no, we're all equal sinners. Plain and simple. There's no wiggle room for that whatsoever. The spirit still undermined that, through the ages, gradually the women and the men, but generally the women are much more clever about it. That's how we set it up. Began to undermine. Eventually, started getting popes that they were just the puppets of the wealthy aristocracy in Italy. They're just puppets. They're still puppets. What pope can really speak the truth? What priest can really speak the truth? If they do, they find themselves banished to Siberia because you're cutting off our funding. And they always say, well, look, yeah, what you're saying is true. We know that. But if our funding's cut off, nobody's going to be, hearing. And they say, well, wait a minute. If we're not speaking the truth in order to get the funding, then what people are coming to hear is not the truth. So, I mean, how is that a win? How is that winning? They don't really have an answer for that. And obviously, we're not winning here in the world. We're not winning. In fact, we're losing big time. Really, really losing. So the way it's done throughout history is you get the marketers who soft pedal it all, and ultimately the money filters out up to these monasteries where people really who really want to get it, they focus in on the truth. But that's kind of kept secret from the laity. You don't publicize it. This is how it's worked throughout history. And so what we try to do is mainstream it because of this crisis we're in. But it doesn't really work, does it? Yeah, but I hate secrecy. I don't like living a duplicitous life. I say, we, you know, but this is, you know, this is how the funds come in through the church, and I'm reassuring, yeah, you know, you're not really as bad a sinner as they are. That's fine, and so they get donations. All through the donations support the monks, the nuns, and those who, and this is kind of how it's been throughout history, but. Boy, do I dislike that, really. But it seems to be, if you speak the truth here, then you're an orphan. What a terrible situation, isn't it? I just don't like it. I just don't go for it. I'm no good. I can't market, be like that type of marketer. Somebody thinks they can put me in that role. They're crazy. That's totally opposite. From the kind of role that I could function in is you know, telling lies to the laity to get money, and then channeling that money to monasteries. The whole thing is stinks, and at some point the laity finds out about it, and then you get this collapse that's coming in the world. So, you know, the pure Christianity is just a great teaching, which is that we're all equal sinners. There's no difference in sin in any of us. We're all, if you miss the mark, you're missing it 100%. And what you're missing is that you can't miss the mark. It's impossible. So it's like saying that if you miss the mark once, I say, well, yeah, I can hit the mark 99% of the time, but if I miss it, but I can miss it just one time. This is to say that reality is not omnipresent, which is to deny reality. And this is what Jesus is getting at, very wonderfully getting at, is reality is omnipresent. There's no parts to it. You cannot accept 99% of it and then say, but there's 1% of it's not omnipresent. To do that is a total denial of reality, which is then what? Total arrogance. So this is what we haven't gotten yet. This is what's taught in the monastery. If you want to know what's taught in the monasteries and all, it's this. It should be this. What's the secret teaching of the Tibetans? Well, it's just this. The apex viewpoint of no viewpoint. You can't miss the mark. It's impossible. No one's ever not been enlightened. It's impossible to miss the mark. So to believe that we can miss the mark even once is total arrogance. And then we have to, then we, to be totally arrogant means you have to make an excuse. Is the mind making an excuse? Just to God say, no, God, I was really arrogant, but not totally arrogant. Isn't that exactly what we're talking about? Meaning, I can hit the mark 99% of the time, God, but 1% is, I missed the mark. This is again to deny reality entirely. So you see how we're looking at this. Just looking at getting comfortable with it. You don't have to immediately grasp and put it together. Say, I got it. I don't try to say I got it. I just keep looking at it and get familiar with it, so it's easy to look at it. Now, some of the very determined people in history have had communities where they're self-sufficient. They're not relying on donations. The Desert Fathers of Egypt, for instance. They would grow their own food, they had their own water, food, you know, they built their own homes, and then they'd have sell the surplus to people, you know, outside of the community, and they'd build things with their hands, so they'd have commerce, and they were able to buy things that if they couldn't make it, they could buy it so they would not be beholden to any aristocracy, any donations, anything like that. And so they were then able to actually focus on the truth and accept the fact that no one's ever not been enlightened. It's impossible to not be enlightened. This is really what enlightenment is realizing it's impossible that no one can ever not be enlightened. No one can ever be not enlightened. It's completely impossible for anyone to miss the mark at all. Totally impossible. That's what enlightenment is. This way of looking at it, right? It's not my enlightenment. I'm enlightenment. You're not. No, it's seeing that it's impossible for anyone to miss the mark. Where could you shoot an arrow that doesn't hit reality? What could you be doing that you're not doing now, right now? What could you be experiencing that you're not experiencing right now? A fantasy of the future is being experienced right now. So is a fantasy of the past. So is a fantasy of no now. That's also being experienced right now. So when has anyone not been enlightened? See, when has anyone not been enlightened? This is the question we need to ask ourselves. How is it possible? Where has someone not been enlightened, and when has anyone not been enlightened? Bug. What are bugs doing flying around in dark? They're supposed to be sleeping. Because I got the light on. They say, there's the sun. I see the sun. It's not time to go to bed. Where has anyone been outside of enlightenment? When has anyone ever done anything to miss enlightenment? It's not right now. It's not right here. When has anyone ever been someplace other than right here? Not right here, now. Not here. And not now. Has that ever taken place? Has it ever taken place? And if you can say, I it's not possible, well then, how is it possible that anyone's not been enlightened? That there's ever been anyone's not enlightened? Isn't it right to say that no one has never not been enlightened? No one has never been not enlightened. Or unenlightened. No one has ever been unenlightened. No one has ever been not enlightened. No one has ever been not enlightened. This is sort of a theme that this is a great affirmation for us. Super great. No one has never been not enlightened. And these videos here are really giving teaching out that you would get in these monasteries and retreats and high teaching situations throughout history that were so secret, you know, because you know, the blackmail that we're all under. This is what you'd be getting. No one has ever not been enlightened. So you're getting it right here. And you're getting it from a situation that's not funded at all. You know, that's not a surprise. That's not a surprise. There have been attempts to pull me into certain things, but it was very transparent. The yoga girls, they usually make the approach and they say, wow, we really love you, you know, and maybe you should come over here. And of course, it's completely obvious that they're controlling the whole situation through blackmail. So in other words, if you say what they want to hear you to say, you get money. If you don't, you don't get any. And what they want you to do is to be dependent upon them. So then by cutting off your funds, you feel you can't survive. But I still can't tell people around me what I'm doing at all. Definitely I get funds. I certainly have help surviving in certain ways. So I'm not totally self-sufficient. But, you know, who is in this world right now totally self-sufficient? And even these communes, you know, the same thing. No, we can't say that, you know. But in order for this whole dance of distraction to take place, we have to see someone as more arrogant and someone as less. We have to. Otherwise, we'd see everything as 100% arrogance and the distractions would dry up, our cognitive fear would dry up, and we'd see as it isness. We'd experience, I am the as it isness. There's only as it isness. So in order for this delusion to keep on being delusion, we have to see more and less arrogance. And so whether it's men that are more arrogant or women that's more arrogant, it's the same game, isn't it? It's the exact same game. And it just happens to work out that it works better for the women to say men are more arrogant. It's much easier to play the game that way. Because then we feel that there's hope for the future in this game we're playing, because the women raise the children. And we say, well, we don't want to raise arrogant children. So if the women are less arrogant, that means, well, we think that we're getting better. We're making progress that way. Because they're really, women are the ones who really raise them each generation, actually. They set all the foundation for it. So if we think that they're more arrogant, we say, oh my gosh, we're going downhill then. So that I mean, it's getting worse. So in order to think it's getting better, we have to believe that men are more arrogant than women. And so this is what we've done, because we want to have this big belief that the world's going to get better. And so in order to do that, we've decided that we're going to abandon Christianity and claim that women are much less arrogant than men. And by putting them in charge of the world and our future destiny, that we could then equate this, that the world's bound to get better. And this is what's called liberalism. Liberals believe the world is bound to get better because they're putting women in charge. This is their ideology. This is just, again, we pointed out, this is just keeping delusion going. This is how we distract ourselves from as it isness. And the traditional Christian position right now, you say, is more conservative, politically conservative, which is say, yeah, Ben would say, yeah, we're arrogant. Okay, guess what? So are you. And let's stop play these games about who's more and less arrogant. We're all sinners, all equal sinners here. In the eyes of God, we're all equal sinners. There's no greater or lesser sinner at all. Jesus said, why are you calling me good? That's something he very severely put down. Don't call me good. That's the game of lesser, greater and lesser sinners, which is what keeps the whole distraction going. So, you know, if liberalism wins the day in this planet, then we're all stalling out back into this horrible game that Christianity was designed to help free us from. And it was you know, one of the big, maybe the biggest push in history was Christianity. And that's why the ego has done its utmost to undermine it. Buddhism was another big push. You know, there've been some big pushes in the world. Islam, another big push. Okay, there's big pushes that have happened. Judaism, big push. And some people in those traditions, they're wise to this, you know. There's some wisdom there, and they say, "Whoa, wait a minute here. We're all equal sinners. That's the way we have to look at it here. Let's stop playing this game, and let's understand that we will play this game as if women are less arrogant than men. But the women have to realize that's not true at all. But we have to play it to have any feeling of getting better in the world, getting betterness, which is just a convention. We're not getting better. There is no world to get better. It's like saying I have better distractions. I have less arrogance, you know, or something. This is a game. So the wise women, they know that this game is being played to make it seem like, well, there's hope for the future. But in their attitudes, they say, no, I know that's just a convention. That's not true at all. We're all equally arrogant here. It includes me. And I need to take responsibility mentally for my suffering and seeming estrangement from God, my regrets. My regrets only vanish when I realize they never happened at all in the first place. Nothing has ever happened. So there were a lot of wise people, both women and men, from these traditions that I mentioned, the big pushes, a lot. But this is, materialism has gradually eroded that and collapsed it. Like a great flood collapsing the levees. We had levees to contain this river of self-delusion. Yeah, like the Mississippi River, levees, and it rains so hard, the rain of materialism has been so severe that the river is flooded, and the levees and all the land is now flooded with this extreme delusion. And the women have just lost it, you know, in terms of their true humility and realization that, hey, the more they buy into these lies, the more they're just buying future lies of excuses of severe suffering from themselves. That's all they're doing. You know, they don't think, they don't see us. No, we finally found the culprit. It's men. That's where the arrogance is. We just get rid of that, crack the whip, and we're going to have a great future. You know, this is the height of, you know, just of silliness, actually. The depths of silliness. And that's just extreme. Now, it's extreme. I mean, the difference between the culture now and 60 years ago is quite extreme. Quite extreme. There was a little more balance back then. Sure, the women were still extremely arrogant and controlling back then. and blaming the men, but the men could stand up for themselves a bit more. The women couldn't quite institutionalize it the way it's been. Feminism institutionalized this deceit, and they, you know, they had to read their Bible, so to speak. You know, they couldn't. They at least had to put on airs of being humble. But obviously, it was just putting on airs, pretty much, because otherwise, this current situation not likely to take place. So, but even putting on airs prevents a complete stall out. Okay, even having to act like you're humble is helpful. And this is what feminists hate. What they really hated was putting on airs like they're humble. They said, oh, we're so tired of that. You know, we don't really believe that stuff anyway. You know, we're not arrogant. You guys are arrogant, and we're not going to even put on airs anymore about it. This is a big mistake. You know, a tragic, catastrophic mistake. It is, you have to keep the culture of austerity going. There's a saying, once women become like man-eaters, like a tiger, tigress becomes a man-eater, they don't stop. They don't stop, which is true. It's very true. And of course, this is all the play of spirit. It's the body of a woman, the body of a man, they're not doing anything. They're just puppets. But these are conventions we're talking about. But there's a saying, like, once an elephant goes rogue, that's it. Once a tiger gets the taste of human flesh, they don't stop. It's very bad. But ordinarily, they don't do that. And so once you got this feminism going, which is what's happened, they don't stop. They can't stop. They're saying, no, I'm going to crush you because you're the one who's arrogant. And my happiness depends on getting rid of arrogance. And once they get used to crushing men, they don't stop. This is what I've seen. And nobody's been able to stop them yet. At all. It's like a flood. The levees are gone. And the wise women of the world got to be shaken in their boots, because they realize the consequences of this for themselves. If they get pulled into this, they're going to get pulled into excuse making, which is what? Rebirth. The mind that's making an excuse has no choice but to identify with something they think is not mind, which is then controlling mind. And this is this hideous birth in bodies and something. That this is what will happen to you. You will experience this as if you're trapped in a body, in a world that's dictating to you how you feel. This is inevitable. There's no other way around it. Otherwise, none of this would be happening here at all. This movie projection wouldn't be taking place at all. So the wise women of the world have to be shaking in their boots just as bad as the men, maybe even worse. But they're still thinking, is there some way to finesse this? And there's no way to finesse it. So we're all shaking in our boots. Most certainly we are. Don't think that everybody, like in Nazi Germany, weren't shaking in, thought it was great. There's plenty of people who were shaking in their boots, not just the Jews and the gypsies and the gays and all of that, the different people that didn't fit in, the communists, whatever. There are a lot of people who are shaking in their boots, men and women. But nobody spoke up. Hardly anybody spoke up. Those who did were, you know, hammered down. So there just isn't anyone speaking up about this, except it seems like here. That's it. I can't find anyone else. Otherwise, I'd be paying attention, say, yeah, great job. No, they're not speaking up. Which just means they're shaking in their boots. Well, I am too. But, you know, you better get off your knees. Once you get on your knees, it's hard to get up. Just try being on your knees and trying to get up. Ah, you know, it's difficult. It's tough. It's tough to get off. You know, when you're pinned down, it's tough to get up. These feminists are man-eaters. There's no question about it. They're rogue man-eaters. And they're everywhere. The whole culture now is saturated with this. But again, this is a disastrous thing for men and women. Disastrous. This acceptance that women are less arrogant than men is a total disaster for the world. And to put the faith in believing that this is going to bring us a happy world again is disastrous. But it's just perpetuating this convention of distraction. Is all it is doing. It's all it's doing. Nothing more than that. It's just simply a convention of distraction. And yet the distraction, losing the momentum that we built up, saying we're all equal sinners here. There's no levels to arrogance at all, which is what Jesus was saying. There's no levels to arrogance. To lose that precious, all-important jewel is disastrous. And this is what we've thrown away. It's in the mud now. I'm trying to clean it off. So at least the women should put on airs again of humility. That at least prevents a full-scale stall out. And I know that they say, oh no, I want to be a liberated woman. You know, be a whore, basically, is what they're saying. Materialistic whore. They want to be a whore of Babylon. I'm tired of putting on airs. I'm this ferocious man-eater. You know, that's what I really am. That's just spirit, you know, in its distractions. It's a continuity fear. And they say, no, I don't want to go back to being the meek, humble. But that's what you got to do. That's the first step. You have to, if you have to put on airs, then you got to go back and start there with your dress, your body language, your demeanor, your deference. Because again, this world, if we don't do that, we've seen it automatically tends to go towards this ideology of feminism in order to put hope in the future. Automatically. You have to believe, we have to believe that the women are less arrogant and that gives our children a chance. That's it. But the children have no chance. The coming here, they're 100% arrogant in the first place. So the only chance they have is repentance. And if the parents aren't repentant, if the parents don't show them are equally arrogant, all arrogance is 100% arrogance, then they have no chance, basically, you know, other than their own, you know, great effort. They have no cultural chance at all. So the idea that we're raising better generations is simply not true at all. We're raising terrible generations of super unrepentant repentance. And they may say, well, you got no place here then. Well, what's that mean? I have no place in no place? Well, yeah, guess what? All of us have no place in no place. There is no such thing as no place. No one has ever not been enlightened. No one has ever not been enlightened. It's impossible to miss the mark. Now, we translate sin as missing the mark, but what it really means is we believe it's possible to miss the mark. So this is a flipping the script thing. Don't think that Christianity has been presented in its clear purity very much throughout history. It, you know, the spirit is tried to manipulate it. So it's not that we're missing the mark. It's that we believe it's possible to miss the mark. But that is the delusion, which means that God is not God. So God bless Jesus Christ for coming back and giving us A Course in Miracles where he straightens us out. Straightens us out. For those who want to be straightened out and see, you know, wow. But I said, Jesus, you know, you got to know what's going on here. I'm sure he does, but I don't know what his plans are. I mean, what I'm saying is what I am experiencing here in the world. Directly and have my whole life. These are the dynamics that keep this delusion going. They're ferocious. And the history of Christianity has been under this ferocious assault, the whole history. And it's gotten all skewed up. So why would Jesus have to come back in the first place if it didn't get all skewed up, which he said it did? So that must mean it's ferocious. The defenses are ferocious, which he says they are. So I must be experiencing this ferocious defensiveness, which I am. So where does that leave us? Me, you, where does that leave us? Jesus, you know, we'd like to know your perspective on this, right? The only hope we have is the teachings that all arrogance is 100% arrogance, that it's impossible to miss the mark at all, completely impossible. So if we say, well, I can miss it one out of a million times, that's 100% arrogance. See, this is the whole key to our sanity. If I miss the mark, I'm shooting arrows, I miss the mark one out of a trillion times, that's 100% arrogance. If I miss it one out of, you know, a billion trillion times in a, you know, a zillion years, I miss it just once, that's 100% arrogance right now. That's 100% arrogance. This is the teaching of Jesus Christ. All praise and glory to Jesus Christ for this teaching. And this isn't anything different than the high teachings of other traditions either, actually. But it's kept pretty secret. Jesus kind of spilled the beans with A Course in Miracles. He sort of brought it mainstream. Says, you know, here it is. You really need to, because it's so tough for us now to get into any of these monastic traditions because they're disintegrating. So he took this risk and said, okay, it's going to be tough for you, but this is the truth. And of course, like, I hear this, I say, holy cow, I hope nobody knows this is what I think. You'd be a pariah in society, because society is based on the hope for in the future. And that is structured now as believing that women are less arrogant than men. So that the raising of the children, we think they're being raised in a better way than before. And yet they're not. In fact, they're being raised in a worse way than before. The last three or four generations have been raised in a much worse way than previously. Because before, at least you had to put on the airs. At least you had to, the structure was there. And that's way better than not doing it. The austerity was there. It was forced out. Of course, women didn't like it, neither did men. Of course, the ego's saying, oh, I hate this. So feminism was just the ego busting out and saying, hey, we don't have to do this anymore. You know, let's get back to the ego here. Enough of Christ. That's all that it was. Really, if you look at how it's developed and how it really is now, that's what it's all about. Get back to the ego. And so Jesus countered that with A Course in Miracles, saying, no. Even if you miss the mark one out of a zillion times, in a zillion eons, that's still 100% arrogance right now. And there's no wiggle room at all in that. This, if you want to know the teaching of Jesus Christ, this is it. And if you want to know the teachings of Longchenpa, this is it. If you want to know the teachings of any of these Dharma kings, this is it. It's that simple. Again, in a zillion eons, if you miss the mark even one time out of a zillion efforts, that is 100% arrogance right here, right now. 100% arrogance coming from the mind and not from anywhere else. And all you have to do is recognize that, and then you realize that it's impossible for anyone to not be enlightened. No one has ever not been enlightened. And then this is the vision of oneness. And you see, you experience as it isness. You realize you are the as it is. Everything is the as it isness. There's nothing other than that. And so this is it. This is the whole teaching. In it's not in a nutshell. It's just simple. But where we go astray is the same old way always. You say, yeah, but that zillion and first shot that misses the mark, that's the one. Yeah. No. The zillion and first one also is the same. And again, a zillion eons and eons and eons and eons and eons and galaxies and universes and trillions of universes, etc. One miss of the mark is still 100% arrogance right now. So why do we need to even dream of time? Because that's all we're doing. We're saying, but Jesus, you don't know, but way in the future, you know, in this universe and there's trillions of galaxies and stuff, we're going to miss the mark, and that will actually be a legitimate miss. Jesus says, no, it won't. That belief is a belief you're having right now, and that's 100% arrogance right now. This is the real teaching, and no other teaching is real other than this, actually. This is the root, the heart of all teaching. is there's no wiggle room. There's never been anyone who's not enlightened, never been any non-enlightenment whatsoever. It's impossible. So sin is not missing the mark. It's believing that the mark can be missed. Okay? It's that simple. And by believing that we are in time, space, process, and form, we are all believing we can miss the mark. It doesn't matter if we think, well, we're going to miss it one time in a zillion efforts. That's exactly the same as saying, I'm going to miss it every time. It's exactly the same. So this flattens out our whole dream of time, space, process, and form, doesn't it? Accepting this is able to just flatten the whole thing out, and we realize it's all just right now. There's no extension to it at all. All these dreams of missing the mark are happening right now. They're not happening a zillion years from now. That's a projection of our belief, and that belief is coming from our mind right here, right now. Yeah, it's a hot evening. There's not a breath of air. Only air is what I'm speaking. There's a little chill in the air. If I move the air, okay. It'll come. It'll come. At least it's not too humid. So again, the heart of it all, the core of it all, is there's no wiggle room at all. And so we need to look at this and play with this and just say, yeah, 1,000 years, 1,000,000 years. If I have 1,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000, And I think I can miss the mark just once there. That's 100% arrogance right now. Zero wiggle room to this. Just say zero wiggle room, and just practice this like this. And you will realize that you have reached the supreme practice. You found it. And of course, there's going to be a wow when you realize you found it. But you say, "But it's so simple. There's no wiggle room." Yeah, it's so simple. That's all that it is. And you see how a culture of at least we put on airs of equal arrogance, how important that is. So we don't go too far astray. When we've experienced now going too far astray in the world, and we're about ready to experience the devastation that this brings. However that devastation shows up, it's all the same, isn't it? It's all the same. As we've gone astray from our momentum towards finding the heart of the teaching. It's not easy to find the heart of it, which is there's no wiggle room at all in time, space, process, and form. Time, space, and process, and form is just an excuse to make us think there's some wiggle room. It's just a mental projection, which is happening right here, right now, of an excuse of what we call wiggle room. There's some wiggle that yeah, I can miss it at least once, somehow, somewhere, someplace, in a trillion universes, in a trillion years, in a trillion attempts, that ultimately I can miss it just at least one time. Okay, that's 100% arrogance right here, right now. And people might say, spiritual people say, "Yeah, I know what you're saying is true, but you can't really say that." It's too much. Don't say too much. But all this has look where the world's at right now. We're all thinking the future's going to be this millennium, this wonderful millennium, because we figured out who to pin the blame upon. And I can tell you for a fact, being a elderly white male, that's where the blame is trying to be pinned on. My whole life, I've felt targeted. I've never had a moment in my life where I didn't feel that I was the bad guy. It's my fault that we're not all happy, right? And if you just accept that, we'll all be happy. If you accept the blame, if you accept the scapegoatingness, we'll all be happy. So they scapegoated Jesus. They said, "Jesus, let us scapegoat you, and this will bring us happiness." Jesus said, "Okay, we'll see how that works out." Yeah, did it bring happiness to Jerusalem? The Roman Empire, anything, scapegoating. Then they made up this thing. No, it will bring happiness eventually, which is again wiggle room. It bought us wiggle room, so we know there is an exception. We can find it. No, Jesus came back and said, no, you missed it. Believing you can miss the mark is missing it entirely, so to speak, meaning it's 100% arrogance, and you're not realizing it's 100% arrogance. And arrogance is meaning completely your own mind that is doing this, and there's nothing else doing it. You cannot miss the mark. It's impossible. Reality is omnipresent. You cannot miss reality. It's impossible. And any belief you are is nothing but sheer arrogance. Sheer arrogance. There's not degrees of arrogance. It's just sheer arrogance. This is Jesus' message to us. No wiggle room. And we think, oh, that's a too tough teaching. No. It's avoiding this teaching that's the tough part. Believing that lies can bring happiness to us. That's what's tough, because you'll find yourself identifying with excuses continually. You continue to identify with excuses, which means form, time, space, process, and form, as if it were influencing how you feel. And then you have to try and manipulate it to try to feel better. This is hell. That is hell. We're in this hellish mental state right now. We're in this in terms of projecting this. We're projecting this hellish mental state of believing there's something that's controlling how we feel, and that we have to manipulate it and make laws and all this kind of stuff, and then we'll be happy. And this is liberalism, is we got to make control everything. Whereas conservatives tend to say, look, no, that's not so much control. There's something fishy about that, you know, right? And the two go back and forth, and, you know, liberals condemn everything conservatives do in terms of, yeah, there's no regulations, you're ruining the planet, blah, 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 all this kind of stuff. Well, no, capitalism is doing that. it's not conservatives necessarily. There's capitalists who are just kind of rogue. I mean, they're, you know, but it's our own arrogance that's, quote unquote, destroying the planet. And what we're doing is we're making it worse. It's amazing how one hand doesn't know what the other's doing. It's just bizarre. Where's the austerity? You know, conservatism used to stand for austerity of life, meaning a simple, austere life. Read your Bible, go to church, or you hear the preachings of austerity, and everybody polices one another in terms of, hey, remember, we need to lead, Jesus told us to lead an austere life, this is the way. And so you have a community, strong community, grassroots, family, faith-based culture, which keeps this mood of austerity going. Now, sure, a lot of it is just airs, and the ladies have to toe the mark, and they have to cover their heads in church, and they have to, you know, they have to make themselves look demure and austere, and you're not going, it's not a social club, it's not a flirtation place, it's not a hookup place, it's all these rules that keep them from, they have to toe the line of austerity. But this is necessary. This is necessary. And we've seen now the consequences of dropping that austerity. It's disaster. And people are trying to celebrate that disaster as if celebrating a disaster somehow means it's not a disaster. This is the insanity of arrogance and the ego, right? Celebrate disaster and it's good. Yeah. So that's what's coming. The disaster's coming, and then the manias of celebrating that disaster are coming. And this is, well, we have to avoid this. We have to be very careful and be austerely avoid that. Little spiders running around there. And people say, what's the matter? You know, if you don't celebrate it, you're going to suffer. So the way to cure disaster is to celebrate it. That compounds it. It says, yeah, we finally won. Great victory. So if we've had all these disasters, cultural disasters of destroying the will of austerity, and we spend our time now celebrating them, having parades and celebrating this, it's great. You know, we finally destroyed that wicked, wicked austerity, you know. Chastity, right? No divorce, you know, chastity, all the stuff that produces an austere life, an austere culture, which enables us to get into deeper practicing and start evaporating our continuity fear. It's essential to have a mental austerity where you block out the distractions. You have to. And if you have a culture that everyone's just grabbing at you and yanking you into distraction, which is what our culture is now. I mean, the way women dress is just basically, they're like mentally raping you, basically, okay? And just forcing you, grabbing you into this, you know, into this mental distraction. It never used to be that way. I mean, well, from time to time in decadent societies, but Christianity, you don't. When you go out, you dress down, very austere, so you're not distracting anyone. So they're celebrating the great defeats, these catastrophes for themselves. It's catastrophic for them. I mean, it's not catastrophic for me. I have the austerity. The ones that it's catastrophe for are the ones celebrating as if it's some kind of victory. This is insanity. Okay, the culture is insane. Particularly liberal culture is insane. Actually, a lot of us know that. Because they have these huge defeats. Defeating austerity is a catastrophe. And then they spend their time celebrating this defeat. Their terrible defeat. Their terrible downfall. It's a downfall for them. They celebrate their own downfall. And they want to have a culture of celebrating their own downfall. You know, it's just like... And this is kind of tough, you know, when your whole purpose is to help others. You know, they spend all their time... They don't listen to what you say. They celebrate. They spend all their time celebrating their own downfall. As if that's the cure. So again, we're just looking at this. We look at this. Wow. This is true, isn't it? And the complaint was, we're losing our spirit. Well, no, you're losing the spirit of arrogance. We've got to put on airs. Well, it makes it difficult for us to celebrate our defeats. Oh, yeah. It's supposed to make it difficult for us to celebrate our defeats, our downfall. Because the ego is telling us we're supposed to celebrate our downfall. We're supposed to have a downfall. We're supposed to celebrate our own downfall. So how can we celebrate our own downfall unless we have a downfall? So the ego says the key to happiness is everyone be miserable and celebrate it. And then we're not miserable because we're celebrating. Yeah, but how long does the celebration last, and how do you feel afterwards? What's the hangover like? And then what do you do? See, ego says, oh, I hadn't thought about that. Yeah, well, mental chaos will solve that. You just your mind is so freaked out, it doesn't know anything, you can't figure anything out. Mental chaos, that's the ego's trump card. Yeah, mental chaos, that'll work. Hides all its insanity. But again, how simple the teaching is. Okay, and that is, there's no wiggle room. It's impossible for us to miss the mark of reality. Totally impossible. And our arrogance is the belief we can, that somehow, some way, we can miss the mark, shoot an arrow, and it's not going to hit reality. That somehow that arrow is going to leave its own intrinsic spaciousness at some point. It's no longer. I mean, where's an arrow? Is it not in its own intrinsic spaciousness, along with everything else? How can it leave that? How can this bottle leave its own intrinsic spaciousness that it's appearing in? In a trillion years, will it leave it? You know, it's absurd. It's absurd. So we can't miss the mark. It's impossible. There's no wiggle room, and we can just play with it. So it's easy, isn't it? Is this a difficult practice? Not at all. The ego told us, oh, this is really difficult. Because you got to think, okay, well, because like, okay, well, 10 years, no, 20 years, you got to go year after year. Now, how about year zillion and one? How about that one? No, that no wiggle room there? Okay, let's try year zillion and two. No, and the ego says, well, you're going to be at this for zillions of years, this practice, because you got to. So that's what the ego tells us. And we say, no, but all of that zillionness is right here, right now. So we can get it done right here, right now, then one in instantly. So you see the difference? How insane the ego is? We just say, since there's no wiggle room, we don't need to go through any of the years, our catalog, and go one by one by one. It's impossible to miss the mark. So we can, that's a fact right now. And so there's no need to mentally project a zillion years. Not even 1 year, not even one instant. So we don't need to count years. You see that, how the ego scares us into thinking, oh, that'll take so long. But if you give yourself wiggle room, right, in a couple of years, well, you only have to wait a couple of years, but because the ego says, well, at some point there's missed the mark. So you got to go through a zillion years to, in a zillion universes to find that. Gee, that sounds like a tough path for you. Why don't we just accept that right now that we can miss the mark? Because we can't miss the mark. That's why. And therefore, we don't need to project any time or space, process, and form at all as a belief system at all, as a distraction from as it isness at all. And so we can be done with it right here, right now. Oh, nice little cricket. Cool. Love it. Love it. How we doing here? Wow, cruising along, huh? I don't know, what else can I do? I get up, I work out, grab a minute here, grab a minute there. I'm real tired, I sleep, I get up, I tape, work out some more, sleep some more, get up, work. That's it. That's austerity, isn't it? This is what's required. But it's way better than the alternative about celebrating our downfall. The ego tells us the only way you can be happy is celebrate your downfall. So we have to bring about a downfall in order to celebrate it, right? So this is what's been happening in culture. Right now, I mean, we're celebrating the downfall of law and order. This is how insane they are. And again, I said liberals are insane, very insane. There's no question about it. Because they're the ones who believe that celebrating their own downfall is the key to happiness. So they're trying to destroy law and order in this land. Destroy it. It's the police that are arrogant now and not the criminals, This is just obvious insanity to sane people, or at least people have a little bit of sanity, at least trying to put on the airs of being sane. Destroy law and order, which is obviously a terrible downfall. We have a place here in the suburbs, Almaden Valley, where because of police funding, I've said this before, because of police funding, they slashed the budgets of all the police, so they couldn't have any police there anymore. So the police couldn't respond to anything other than an absolute life-threatening situation, there's no more police. They didn't want to respond. What happened? Criminals, obviously, being super opportunists that they are, very clever opportunists, found this out very quickly, and just started brazenly breaking into homes, rich people's homes in Almaden Valley, right during the daytime, anytime at all they want to. Just drive up, force their way in with guns, and the people are there, they just gunpoint, they tie them up, rob all the jewelry, take away, they would drive off. They knew no police would come at all. Carte blanche. And so the whole area has been terrorized by this now. And so these wonderful, hardworking people that live there, they tell me, I got all the money in the world, but we live in terror now. So, downfall of their happiness, severe downfall of their culture and their happiness. And, nobody says a word. They say, hey, let's fund the police. Oh, no, the police are terrible. Let's defund them all. Well, that's engineering a downfall. The liberals engineer downfalls so they can celebrate the downfall. Now, you might say capitalism engineers the downfall of the planet so we can celebrate the downfall of the planet. It's not really capitalism. It's our own lust for materialism, for some sort of feeling goodness. So it's our own arrogance that produces the downfall. Capitalism is simply an efficient way of using up resources really fast. But it's our own. I don't see any austerity in liberals at all. In fact, they're the ones using more resources than anybody, what I've found. You look at the people who have the most, who use, gob up the most resources in their homes and everything, it's in their vacations, it's liberals. It is. You see, the people are like living real austere life. I mean, usually they're pretty doggone conservative. They go to church and they at least put on airs of austerity. You know, this huge, this is the truth, is the ego believes that celebrating our downfall is the key to happiness. So of course you have to engineer the downfall. So what has been happening in America, as I've been saying for a long time, is the party in charge right now is simply engineering the downfall of America. That's all they're doing. They're completely focused on this and celebrating it as they go. I think we're going to have a great, big, huge celebration real soon. And then we'll be happy. The millennium will be here. And we'll be perpetually happy. They're following the advice of the ego, not the advice of the grace of God. Whether it's Tibetan Buddhism, whether it's Christianity, whatever you want to call it. It's all the same as the grace of God. It's the wisdom that there's no wiggle room, that no one has ever not been enlightened, and it's impossible to miss the mark. That's the true wisdom. It's impossible. It's impossible for anyone to not be a Dharma king. Impossible. Totally impossible. That's the real wisdom. And so they are trying to distract us from this. Spirit is distracting us through this mechanism you call liberalism. It's just a distraction mechanism of spirit, of arrogance, of continuity fear, ultimately, of continuity fear. So the more I've evaporated continuity fear, the more I've woken up to this, which is why I can say this. I used to be a super liberal, but it bothered me. It bothered me. I said, something wrong with this whole thing. There's something suspicious about this. I don't quite trust it. And so the more I went on the spiritual path, the more continuity fear I evaporated, the more I began waking up to like, hey, wait a minute, really? Yeah, what's going on here, really? And this has continued to now I can see it very plainly. Is they're simply engineering the downfall of everybody so they can celebrate it. Crush austerity and then celebrate the crushing of austerity. And it's austerity, it's only austerity that enables us to really brings us to this core realization. And we have no choice but to be brought to this core realization. I can never have got to this without the austerity that I've lived in my life. Impossible. Impossible. The ego would still have me thinking, wow, that's going to take a long time to get to that, Get to what? I could see it right here, right now. There's no wiggle room at all. That missing the mark even once is total arrogance. So this insight is completely realizable this very instant. I never could have got to this without tremendous austerity, and thank God for the poverty I've had, that I really couldn't divert myself very easily. You can still divert yourself, actually, but it certainly gives you leverage. It's a great excuse. If you want to be austere, it's a great excuse. I can't take any vacation. Everyone takes, I'm stuck here. I can't do anything. Even golf, I could, cough up, or I don't even cough it up. Someone helps me out with it. $30, but once a month. Now I forget it, forget, yeah. Because the times are too critical. I'm just not doing anything except 24/7 focus on this. And, that was about it. I'd play a round of golf occasionally. Order a shirt occasionally. Maybe I'll order a shirt tonight or something, It's just, if it helps the taping, if it helps us, that I do something, then, I'll do a little something. But I don't travel. I mean, when people talk about austerity, not traveling is a great austerity, actually. It's one of the best. I feel completely stuck where I am. I can't go anywhere. I can't afford a hotel. I can't go anywhere. I don't have any friends. I don't have any place to stay. That's another thing. That's another great austerity is no friends. No friends at all. So the way that most people travel, I'll tell you the truth, is they have friends all over. Different countries, different places in the United States. I have no family. So there's no relatives I can stay with, really, in terms of children, grandchildren, in-laws, nothing. I can't, so there's not one place in the world that I'm aware of that I could stay. Not one place. that someone's house would take me and say, you can stay here. Not even one place. And so it makes it very difficult to travel then, because the way people travel is, yeah, they drive somewhere, they fly somewhere, you know, if they have the money to fly, drive somewhere, and they stay for a week with their friends. And there's just no expense. The friends, you know, they eat the friends' food, they, you know, stay with the friend, there's no expense. And they drive some. I talk to people, yeah, I travel all over. How do you do it? I got relatives, in-laws, friends everywhere. I just stay with them. This is how you do it. But me having no friends anywhere, I can't travel anywhere. So I just have to sit here. And what do I do? What do you do when you sit here? Well, you better find out how to be free of this austerity, ultimately free, so I can go everywhere. You know, I mean, so you look and you have to see, how can I be liberated from this hellish world, really? But when I was young, our family traveled a bit back then. A little bit. So I had the taste of traveling, really. I didn't really like it that much, actually. So I don't really feel like missing anything. It's really a pain, actually. It's not what it's all cracked up to be. But people that are traveling, I think they're getting somewhere. They're buying some time. They're getting some wiggle room somehow. But sure, if I had friends in nice Coachella Valley or something, I'd go there, for sure. But I don't, so I don't go there. So what I do, I spend all my time taping and focusing in on truth. The only place in the world I really want to go would be Coachella Valley, really. You know, other places, you know, not even worth going to, actually. Coachella Valley just has a sort of otherworldly feel to it. It's just, there's something to it that it's just like, it just reminds me of being free of existence. Tibetans, probably places in Himalayas, you know, they're like that. They're the Nepalese, Bhutanese, and the very areas of the Himalayas, there are places that you might feel just like, this just reminds me of like, that this really isn't a world at all kind of thing. But no, I'm still stuck where I don't want to be, really. Silicon Valley. But I find it's positive because it's so terrible. You really want true freedom. I'd never wanted to experience this sort of thing again. You live it in liberal land. It's horrible. Again, I mean, what the Republican convention is like a couple days away, right? And again, I have vast exposure to the Bay Area. As far as driving around, I have to drive around all the time, 100 plus miles a day I drive. And I have yet to see one Trump anything here in the Silicon Valley. A sign in the yard, a bumper sticker, a button on someone, even the slightest indication that Donald Trump even exists. Not even one. Now, if that is not astonishing to you, if that doesn't cause you concern, I don't care what your politics are, if that doesn't make you feel that there's some dictatorship coming, that, and as I said, liberals, their belief is celebrating our failure, the failure of austerity, is happiness. If that doesn't scare you, I don't know what does. I don't care, you know, if Trump loses, he loses. But the lack of plurality in the Bay Area, at least people saying, you know, I'm not quite sure that celebrating or bringing about the end of austerity, that saying that men are the arrogant ones, women are not, that saying there's differences, I'm not quite sure that's the answer. Because Christianity, didn't Jesus tell us that we're all equal sinners? I'm not sure. So the lack of any indication is an extreme overconfidence. You have to say it is a bizarre, catastrophic overconfidence here. We're so confident in the Bay Area that Hillary Clinton is the one that's going to lead us to happiness and that Trump's the one that will lead us to disaster. We're so sure of that. We're 100% sure here. Really? Is that not a sign of drastic overconfidence? And such an overconfidence has to be a belief that we're winning, and the whole winningness of liberalism is to destroy austerity. genuine austerity of mind, of morals. Austerity has to do with moral austerity too. And so they're celebrating the destruction of moral austerity as if that's going to be happiness. So they're 100% sure that's the way here. I have no indication of anyone here that doesn't think that's 100% the way. So how catastrophic is that globally? It's a total stall out here. Total stall out. And again, I feel just like getting a Trump sign and walking around. They say, what do you think about this? How come, does it make you uneasy that you, this is the first Trump sign you've seen in the Bay Area? Does that make you feel like, something isn't quite right? Do you think there's some overconfidence going on? Well, I don't need to do that because, you know, I know what would happen. But actually, I've talked to people who are Trump supporters, but they say, I don't dare give any indication of this. I don't dare do it. My house is going to be vandalized. My car is going to be vandalized. My well-being, I'm probably going to be killed. This is what they tell me. This is how they feel. And so this is America? You feel happy with this? Well, in those of you listening to other countries, do you feel happy with an America like this? That there's no plurality? And that the liberals are feel that they totally got the answer? And that's to destroy all genuine moral austerity in the world? And you think that is going to work? I mean, you got to be trembling in your boots right now, as I said before, if you have any wisdom at all. Because that's what's coming. That's what's coming your way. That's the tsunami that's coming your way. But half of the country doesn't really feel that way, basically. Maybe more than that, but they're scared to say so. But we've been so intimidated that not one of us can even have a Trump bumper sticker. Again, zero. Zero. Zero here. Zero. Not one. And I see thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of cars every day. I mean, I'm exposed. If there was one, I would see it. You know, that kind of thing, right? Now, maybe there's someone, maybe one person somewhere in the Bay Area. But the percentage is so minuscule that in no way mitigates this disastrous situation here of overconfidence. In no way. That's like saying all the country clubs, you know, in the South, there's one black member. It was, oh, what do you mean? It's all integrated, you know, come on. There's one, you know, right? Do you think the liberals would fall for such chicanery? So why should anyone else fall for their chicanery? Someone has a Trump bumper sticker, but we got plurality here. What are you talking about? I mean, that's just, it's even more absurd than the non-integrated country clubs, however you want to look at that. I mean, there are plenty of people who feel that every people have a private country club, which is the whole purpose is a certain kind of mental moral austerity, have every right to control what their membership is. And you can't produce some sort of quota for them. That's totally anti-American, anti-religious, etc. There are plenty of belief that way. But using as an example, you know, the liberals say, well, that's completely absurd. You're like idiots to think we're pulled by that. Well, they're pulling off something that's even vastly more absurd. And thinking that we're idiots to notice it. And again, in a lot of ways, I'm liberal, actually, in a lot of ways, you could say. And I used to be a liberal, and the Liberal Party but was hijacked for by these radical egomaniacs, you know, literally. Let's celebrate the downfall of civilization. Let's celebrate the destruction of moral austerity, and then we'll be happy because we'll all be celebrating. So I don't want to hang around for some celebration of the downfall of this planet. Why should we hang around for that, folks? It's pathetic. You know, it's sheer arrogance, dancing, you know, a dance of sheer arrogance. Well, does that help our moral austerity? No, it doesn't. So we're not going to hang around for it. We're going to go back to establishing a moral austerity again. Okay? Whether we like it or not. Do I like moral austerity? Not entirely. Do I like all this type of austerity? Not entirely. No. Nobody. I mean, I'd like to be able to do whatever the heck I want to do. Right? But that's stupid. Yeah, I thought, what, you'd go get drunk and walk around in public like an idiot, you know? If I want to be able to do that, I should be able to do that. Yeah, shouldn't be any laws against it, blah, 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 whatever. No. I mean, yeah, there should be. Yeah, there should be. And there should be moral austerity. It's for everyone's benefit, spiritual benefit. So, of course, it's not easy. But getting free of our continental fear is not easy. And we got no choice but to get free of it. We got no choice but to finally see there's no wiggle room at all. It's impossible for us to miss the mark completely. Not one time out of a zillion in a zillion galaxies. No, never. And in order to get to that, you really cannot keep distracting yourself from as it isness with celebrating the downfall of this perspective, as if you can't get to this perspective. And let's celebrate that we can't get to this. Let's celebrate our, arrogance. That'll never work. It'll never work. So yeah, I don't like us all austerity. Yeah, it's like, you mean I gotta work out? Oh, come on. I'm gonna get tired. Oh, really? I mean, but I know it's good for me, so I do it. And this is the attitude you have to have. And this is the attitude that's trying to be destroyed here on this planet. If it feels good, do it. Whatever you want to do is perfectly fine. No, it's not. There shouldn't be any laws that tell me what I can do and stuff. This is pragmatic idiocy. And they interpret, A Course in Miracles, they interpret Dzogchen, and they interpret like, oh, that's what they're saying. Now, words give you wiggle room. Okay. Teachers seem to give you a little wiggle room. I know Jesus said that we shouldn't judge what anyone does whatsoever. Well, fine. You don't have to judge it in order to insist on austerity. That's not a judgment of our freedom. It's a pragmatic step we have to take in order to get us to the state of no judgment. I mean, but we're spirit. So there's this confusion around this no judgment issue. But put that to the side, because the fact is there is no wiggle room. We can't miss the mark. It's impossible. That's the real important realization that you have to look at. Not any of this other stuff, actually. What Jesus is really saying, it's impossible to miss the mark. So, judgment meaning you're judging how who's when the when are you going to miss the mark? How much you're missing it by? So, that's what he's getting at. Is you can't miss the mark. So, reinforcing the belief that you can is counter to our salvation. Totally counter to it. And we need the austerity to get us to this realization that we can't miss the mark. Pragmatically, this has been shown throughout history. As Jesus says, indulging in the special relationship, or this is a disaster for you. This liberal culture is a disaster for us, for everyone. It's a downfall for everyone, for almost everyone. And then compounding that by celebrating it. So what we're trying to do is stop the celebration of it. I mean, when you talk about what conservatives are trying to do, is they're saying we're not going to celebrate the downfall of our civilization. And this is what the liberals are so upset about, because the whole purpose, they say, of the downfall of our civilization is to celebrate it. And the ego says that that will bring us liberation, happiness. And they're trying to spin it in some Dzogchen way. Some of the liberals do, thinking, yeah, this is it. No, that's idiocy, is what it is. Longchamp never intended for Dzogchen to be spun in that direction at all. He's very strict about that. Jamyang Khyentse Choekyi Lodro is very strict about austerity. In no way are you supposed to spin it in this liberal direction of celebrating the downfall of any sort of moral compass at all. In no way. It's abhorrent to them because pragmatically it's a disaster. It busts the Dharma up. It destroys the Dharma. It destroys the momentum. It makes you believe in happiness in the future. Future happiness. That's not right here, right, not based on the fact we can't miss the mark at all, ever. It's not based on realization, it's just based on indulging the flesh, sensation. And this is the maniacs that are running the world now, are egomaniacs, actually. Trying to justify it by throwing up some Dzogchen here and there, and you know, some little Course in Miracles here and there, if they can find it somewhere. They try, you know, but this is not Jesus' intention or Longchenpa's intention or at all. But they think they're very clever by manipulating it this way. Well, yeah, sure, they're clever, but what they're really saying is, yeah, you can miss the mark, and we know how to do it. And what Jesus is saying, no, you can't, and you don't know how to do it. So this whole busting down of moral austerity and stuff is a disastrous thing. Because they say, well, that's the way we feel good. No, it isn't. Temporarily, you might think you get more sensation and thrills. But that's just, that rots away too. It's just, that's just pus, is all it is. Rotting, terrible, stinky pus, really. It doesn't get bring you bliss at all. It doesn't bring you anything lasting. It's just camouflage arrogance is all it is doing. It's just arrogance. You're experiencing arrogance. That's all it is. You're just experiencing an excuse. We say, well, I'm trying to make this excuse a better excuse. I want to be happy with this excuse. Mine's saying, I love this excuse. It makes me feel good. You know, this excuse, this body's make me feel good. This excuse makes me feel good. No, it doesn't. Mine will never feel good believing that it can miss reality. It will always only feel fearful. That's it. It will always only feel fearful, which is what Jesus says. You either experience fear or love, which is his freedom, which is bliss, ultimately. That's it. There's nothing else to experience. And yet, I know everyone will just go right back to making excuses. But hopefully, hearing this, you wow it. You don't try to accept it or reject it. You just wow it. Because, I don't know, it doesn't get much better in this. I keep trying to do better and better and better. But getting to the core of it, you know, that getting to the core of it is getting to the core of it. Getting to zero wiggle room is getting to zero wiggle room. So we're doing really, really well here. So just wow it. Because that's a big deal. It's like, wow, we really are getting to it here. So the conventions are coming out, the United States conventions, political conventions, and this is, you know, where things, everything starts to hit the fan. Because conservatives, if you want to understand American politics, conservatives are basically saying, okay, so we've destroyed civilization, moral austerity. We hate that because we think it's a disaster, but we're not, we got to go along with it because that's the laws are forcing us to, but we're not going to celebrate it. And if we can, we're going to roll it back into, you know, roll back. And the liberals are just furious about this because the whole purpose of tearing down moral austerity and general austerity in general, mental austerity, which says no, you know, say no to drugs, say no to this, say no to this, say no to this, say no to sex, say no to drugs, say no to rock and roll, you know, the whole thing, no to that, say no to partying, say no to all this stuff, say no to making excuses, saying no to saying that someone is less arrogant than someone else, say no to that, say all this stuff that Christianity has helped build up, say no to Christianity, essentially, is what they're saying, and then celebrate that great downfall. And the whole purpose is to celebrate, because the ego says that'll bring your happiness. So they're furious at the conservatives, because the conservatives are saying, we are not going to celebrate. We're not going to stick around for you dancing on our graves. Sorry. You got our graves already, but we're not going to stay around for this, for you dancing on them. And the liberals are just beyond furious about this. Beyond furious. I mean, they're let's set up, you know, let's set up extermination camps as fast as we can for them. That's how furious they are. You know, how dare you deprive us of our happiness, of celebrating our downfall? How utterly wicked of you. How utterly judgmental of you. No, there's two different judgments. There's the pragmatic discernment about works, and there's the ultimate discernment. So Christianity knows you hate the sin, love the sinner. You got to hate the sin. You got to hate arrogance. You can't say, oh yeah, arrogance is there's nothing wrong with it. Oh yes, there is, because it makes us feel fearful. And we can never be happy with feeling fearful. So we don't have any choice. When we keep insisting we have a choice that we don't have, this continues our suffering. So what spiritual teacher is going to come and say, well, yeah, it's perfectly okay. No problem. I approve that you keep going in this direction of saying we have a choice or we don't have any. And in fact, let's strengthen that belief. Well, that's not a spiritual teacher. That's an antichrist who would say something like that. They would say it to get donations and money and support, and let's be able to, but that's antichrist. You know, Jesus came in and said, look, the world's going to hate what I say, and if you say what I say and follow me, the world's going to hate you. That's what Jesus told us, and it's absolutely true. So there have been a lot of spin doctors and doctresses trying to spin A Course in Miracles into making it seem like Jesus is this real compromising, genial rabbi who say, oh yeah, it's perfectly fine that you keep believing you have a choice that you don't have. No problem. Well, of course he says it's perfectly fine you keep celebrating your honoring your creativity and doing this. He says, however, let me tell you, you absolutely could do it all right now. And the ultimate realization is it's always been that way. There's never been any moment when you could not drop the whole thing instantly. And ultimately, you have to come to the realization you don't have any choice at all. So he's very kind, but he's also very adamant. But people have been trying to spin this into thinking, no, there is this other choice. So a lot of people, most people in the world who are pushing the yoga girl spirituality, they're all liberals, which is astonishing to me. Absolutely astonishing. I don't know any one that's a conservative who's speaking like non-dual teaching who's a conservative. I'm very conservative. And rightly so, because I'm not going to stick around for celebrating our downfall. Okay? No way. No way. It's astonishing to me. Absolutely astonishing. All these non-dualists. I think every single one of them just. I mean, if you went to one of the like non-dual conventions, there are many, many spiritual conventions. Let's go to the Course in Miracles thing in Colorado or something. If I wore a big Trump T-shirt, how well would that go over with those folks? In any spiritual gathering in the world right now, if you wore like a Trump T-shirt, how well would that go over with them? And I could tell you would probably be an absolute pariah, and they would want to dance on your grave right now. They would celebrate. They'd pray for your downfall, and then they'd pray to dance on the grave of your dance on the grave of your downfall. This is my feeling. I have yet to hear one single spiritual leader stand up and say, you know what, I'm very conservative. And, quote unquote, the so-called real advanced teachers, where people think the liberals think they're great. I mean, I've yet to hear even one say, hey, wait a minute, folks, this is what's really going on. I've yet to hear even one of them do that, because they're being funded, they're getting rich off of liberalism and the donations of women, and because their women are deciding where the money goes now. So they're getting famous and rich and all this. And so the gravy train, man. I'm not gonna. I know, who's buttering my bread. But again, here, there's no gravy train here. Which is why liberals fear the conservatives. Some of them are very austere. They can live a very austere life, and that freaks them out, because they're willing to speak the truth. They're not dependent. They got farms. They can, you know what? They can survive without any donations at all. And this terrorizes liberals, because they say, no, you all got to be hooked into so many fees and fees, fees, fees. You need a lot of money. You got to be hooked in to the matrix, and then they could then pull the plug on you if they, so they want to be able to pull the plug on you. They most certainly do. Again, I say again one more time, liberals are insane. Okay, plain and simple. Very insane. Dangerously insane, actually. They want to dance on your grave. They want to dance on the destruction of moral austerity, of all mental austerity that denies the flesh. It says, no, the flesh is downfall. It is wicked. Do not indulge in the flesh at all. Let's go towards zero tolerance for the flesh entirely. Ultimately, celibacy. Go for celibacy. No drugs, celibacy. that kind of stuff. Absolutely. We should be aiming for that. Ultimately, that's the push towards very austere, no alcohol, no drugs whatsoever, no caffeine. Ultimately, I know for many that's a tough one, but ultimately you're going towards that. And you accept that. You say, wow, that's really tough for me. Great. There's austerities that are tough for me too. So we're in the same boat and we help each other. The whole idea of a community of saints is you help one another struggling with these austerities, because it's difficult. I mean, no caffeine for me is difficult, yeah, because I feel great when I drink caffeine. I feel like a Superman. And when I don't, I feel like Clark Kent, you know? Yeah. If I drink caffeine, I feel like I'm a world beater. Like I go, I'm Superman again. And so, of course, it's horrible going through every single day feeling like Clark Kent, tired, exhausted, you know, feeling not at my best, etc. But I know firsthand how devastating caffeine is, how devastating it is. It leads to overconfidence. It leads to feeling that, I don't really need these austerities. I don't really need them. And it leads to the downfall of austerities, which I think 95% of the people in the world have some sort of caffeine in, virtually every day in the world. And this has led to global overconfidence, and it's led to us feeling that we don't really need these austerities. Yeah, I know cultures get rid of alcohol and drugs, but they still allow caffeine. Caffeine's the worst drug of all, because it's subtle. It leads to a subtle overconfidence, where you feel austerity's good, but I don't really need it right now. You see, because I feel like Superman or Superwoman, I'd feel super. I feel super abundant. What? Positivity. Okay, but I don't feel super positivity. So what caffeine says, we can be happy with super abundant positivity. We can be, what caffeine does, it says, it makes you feel, we can celebrate our downfall to such an extent that we'll feel happy, because look how great we're celebrating our downfall. I can keep drinking caffeine, I can keep celebrating. Yeah, I feel great. I'm a wonderful downfall celebrating. And so this is what the world's doing, saying there's not no problem. But if you don't use caffeine, you say, big problem. Because I don't feel so great. Even if I was celebrating the downfall, I still don't feel so great. So you got to use the sex, the drugs, and the rock and roll to feel great about celebrating your downfall. If you don't do those, then you say, I feel kind of lousy all the time. Whether I celebrate or not doesn't really help me. That doesn't help me. So I better find out what really works for me. I gotta find out what really works for me. So then you use austerity, so there's no distraction, so you can really focus in and get to the zero wiggle rooms. Zero wiggle room. I can never miss the mark. Nobody can. Even a zillion universes, each one of those universes lasting a zillion eons, not once can I ever miss the mark. Not even once. Okay? And yet all that mental notion of zillions and zillions of universes, which is space, and zillions of eons in each of those zillions and zillions of universes, gone in a linear fashion, so it seems to go on forever. All of that belief in that is right here, right now, in our mind, in my mind. All of it. It never leaves this instant, and it never leaves this here nowness at all. It's 100% here right now. 100% here right now. And this is an experience I had once where I became aware of this of eons of time, and I woke up from just kind of a nap, and I realized that was all happening just in the now, here now, of my mind, entirely. And when I stopped it, all of that vanished instantly. Millions of years, 100 million years vanished instantly, as if it never was. And in fact, it never was. Time and space and process form has never been at all. It's never left the here nowness of our mind. It's never left intrinsic spaciousness of our mind and all appearancing at all. There's never been a speck of time. There's never been a speck of space, time space, as it were, at all. This linear space that we think exists. There's never been a speck of it at all. We look at space as some kind of linear thing, right, of a universe. That's never existed at all. Time, space has never existed. Not even a speck of it. Not even a moment of it. And process and form also has never existed at all. So just hear this and say, wow, okay, great. Get used to this. And get used to, again, if you don't like austerity, you're in the, welcome to the club. You know, it's a love-hate relationship with it. You love it because it works. You hate it because you think it'd be nice to like just feel like super, super abundant positivity. Just to, you know, can I just drink a cup of coffee? I mean, that's all it takes to be one cup of coffee, and it's like I'm Mr. Congeniality. You know, well, you know what? That's the same as people drinking alcohol. You know, just one, you know, a couple shots of alcohol, and they warm up to the world. You know, it's like, wow, the world's, you know, is an interesting place. So I'm smiling and laughing and joking and talking with people, and it seems like, oh, it's so easy. It's just no big deal. It's no big deal. Yeah, it is a big deal. Because that's what's called superabundant positivity, and that's the that's all based on the idea that we can miss the mark, but that's okay, because we got a lot of superabundant time, space, process, and form to party in, you know. But the fact is, we don't have any of that to party in. We don't. And it bites us again and again and again. That's not fair. I should be able to, you know, drink and do as much as party as I want. But it ends up, I feel terrible afterwards. What's going on, you know? That's not fair. It's not fair. Got to be a way around it. No, there isn't. There's no way around fear. Either fear is real or it isn't. If it's real, there's no way around it. And if it isn't, then it's not real right here, right now. And distracting us from that realization is terrible. It's terrible. How are we doing? We're getting close to the end here. Another 2.5 hours just pumping through, you know, just working. I just got the capacity to do that. It's taken me many, many, many years of taping. I'd start out with just little taping. Well, really, I started out with taping my Course in Miracles reactions to a Course in Miracles study, and those would last for hours, actually. So I started out taping for hours. And I tried to do that. And so I really started out pretty strongly. I did hundreds of tapes of A Course in Miracles of showing my path, how the path was working for me. But ultimately, I realized there's no interest in it. Nobody's interested. There's not been one person. Well, I wouldn't say that. Maybe there's been a couple, some viewing here, who've interested in my Course in Miracles work a little bit. You know, right? Okay, thank you. That's great. But other than that, nobody has been interested in my Course in Miracles study at all. None. Zero interest. It's like, wow. I say, folks, I've been at it almost 40 years, very intensely. Zero interest. I said, yeah, but you're not going through the official channels of being certified. I said, what do you mean certified? I'll let Jesus certify me. Jesus has certified me. Actually, he has, by inviting me to his dwelling place. That's, you can't get any better certification than that. And speaking, inviting us to relate with him as a friend, and I accepted his invitation, and we did relate with one another as friends. You don't get any of that certification right there. But no, that's not the certification they're looking for. They're looking for, you got to go through the ego certification, so we make sure that you can follow along the ego's plan of being happy, celebrate our downfall. Make sure the yoga, you got to be certified by the yoga girls, basically. If you want to get anywhere spiritually in the world right now, it seems like you have to be certified by the yoga girls. Otherwise, you don't exist. You don't exist. It's amazing. This is what I found. I don't exist to these people. I don't exist at all. They invite me. Yeah, come up to our conference. But who's inviting me? The yoga girls are. They're all. The registration, you got to talk to. It's always the yoga girls that you got to talk with first. And they are evaluating you. Are you buying into the liberal, you know, shtick about feminism, basically? Are you buying into that? And if you're not, you'll find the door slammed in your face. So you have to lie to them if you want to attend any conference, basically. I'm not willing to lie. You know, I'll tell them how I feel. So then, of course, they, you know, act like I'm the devil itself. So I don't need the aggravation to do that. So I don't go anywhere. I don't go to attend any conference, do anything. You know, who wants to be, you know, oppressed? You know, I don't seek out oppression. Don't seek out oppression. Why should you? You don't have to seek out oppression. That's why I don't wear the Trump shirt. If you're seeking out oppression, for sure, like the worst kind of oppression. But you don't need to wear it to know, you know, just go out in the sun, you know how hot it is, right? You don't need to climb a mountain to find out how hot it is. You just go out in the sun and, wow, it's a hot day today. Okay. Yeah, that's all you need to do. If it's snowing, you know, you don't need to, you know, need to run around. It's snowing here. Say, it's snowing. You know, I mean, how stupid can you, you know, how do you expect us to be? I don't need to, I don't want people, you know, celebrating on my grave, dancing on my grave. I don't want to hang around for that. Stupid. Insane, actually. Of course, again, nobody can miss the mark at all. It's impossible for us. But believing we can is insanity, is meaning the inverse of sanity. So here you go. You've heard it here, and you're probably not going to hear anything like this anywhere else. I can't find it. I wish I could. I'd like them. I would promote them. I'd say, wonderful. I'm an ally. Nobody wants to touch me. I'm a pariah. Because everyone in this world thinks the answer is more and less arrogance. In other words, not 100%, but seeing it, arrogance is graduated, you know, gradations. Almost everyone in the world is that way. And so when they hear someone is not that way, they say, that's the boogeyman. I don't want anything to do with them. I just ignore him. It's amazing. Everything I do, people just ignored, except here, a few, 50 of you here, you know, courageous, austere, who understand the drastic problems that arise from you, that is all excuse making, and all excuse making is based on this belief that there's levels to to arrogance, and the inability to see that is based on distraction, and distraction is based on a lack of austerity, and the only way to fight